Hi, welcome once again to this series of our episodes on the Central Vista. And thank you, Madhav, for joining us here. And Madhav Raman, who is an architect and who's been a pioneer right since the beginning when this movement started against the redevelopment of the Central Vista and, you know, all those issues that were raised. I think it was 2 years ago when this discussion started, and 2 years down the line, we have now some work being executed. So in the execution phase, actually, Madhav, just to tell you that we have been able to interview a few of your architect friends, and, you know, we have been able to cover some of the important elements of this redevelopment. For example, Romy pointed out that, look, it's more to do with Vastu. That's why they're so determined to go ahead. And, you know, time frame is so important. Then, of course, we had Vivan Sundaraman, who said, you know, it's a kind of metamorphosis from the era of anxiety to the era of fear, where, you know, era of anxiety produces creativity, but here actually we are witnessing the murder of creativity, either we are killing that creativity. And then we have seen also the Supreme Court judgment 2-1, and then again people going knocking the doors of the Supreme Court, and then the high courts asking that, look, at least in the pandemic, spare the people. But then we've seen what the judgment has been and a fine imposed on the petitioners. So given that as a background, but we have also seen the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, the minister himself actually, defending this project very vociferously and saying, look, this is the new era, the modern era that we're talking about. And you see, once we refurbish all this, I mean, it will be very iconic. So I think let's start from there. I mean, what the minister has said, and not to actually miss the point that one of the important elements that this government has been advocating, of course, it comes in a disguised form. It doesn't mention about the Prime Minister's mansion, you know, the SPG, all that stuff, not the public spaces that's being, I just calculated before starting this interview, Madhav. And please correct me if I'm wrong, but I think what I could calculate is it's nearly 120 acres of public land, which is being usurped, you know, and where government buildings, I mean, the PDF that you had sent to me, I mean, I was just going through that document, and actually this is what I could make out. Maybe just correct me if I'm wrong. It's massive, 120 acres right in the heart of the national capital, you know, and you are transforming this land from public land to government offices, and terming that the government offices are also public. But I think, let me just start by asking you, there are certain guiding principles that this government is saying. You know, there are 5 important guiding principles. And according to those guiding principles, the government says, look, this is how we are going to refurbish the Central Vista. And you should allay all your fears and all that is being actually spread outside. I mean, it's not the way. I mean, like you, I, and all of us, we are projecting. So I think, what is your take on it? I think that.
Well, thank you, Tikendra, for having me over. This is the second time, like you pointed out, in almost a year and a half since we spoke. Yeah. And sadly, you know, the thing is that you say movement and these are grand terms, but the fact is that what troubles me most about this project, as it did 1.5 years back, was how the government, or let's say the CPWD, since they are the people driving this project, seems to have a very fast and loose grip on what is legal and illegal and permitted and not permitted as per the bylaws. I mean, I don't need to remind you to go back too far. But in the years 2006 and 2007 in Delhi, there were massive demolition drives for unauthorized construction, massive ceiling drives for illegal occupation, for land use violations. These matters went up to the court then also, since now we are being told that the court, I mean, that is also an incorrect reading of the court judgment. In fact, it's disrespectful of the court judgment, the way the ministry says that it's got a green signal from the Supreme Court. But my point is, in that time, 2006-2007 Delhi High Court, they basically declared that 80% of Delhi was illegal because people weren't taking land use and permitted authorized construction seriously. And this is a fundamental way if you're going to turn a majority urban country in a few years, then urban and municipal laws are at the basis. So I want to first unpack what the ministry in its response calls guiding principles of this project.
Yeah.
I think we should understand that we are not expecting government to give us guiding principles for a project of this scale and nature and impact. We want them to first at least hit the lowest denominator of being legal, so that you don't have to live in the ignominy.
So the government changes in a few years.
So that denominator means demolition drive here.
Okay, you know? That denominator means the basic statutory laws that are existing. Okay.
So in these guiding principles, you actually are seeing the government treat law like it's some philosophical position. So let's look at what they first start with. They start with heritage conservation.
Yes, yes.
You see, when you say guiding principles, it allows, you know, like, I don't know if you've studied philosophy, but if philosophy needs to evolve, you cherry pick from various philosophies to evolve philosophy forward. This is history of philosophy.
But you can't cherry pick law.
You see, law is what the statutes carry at the time of that act. It is not retrospective, it is not speculative, it is what it is at that point in time. And right now they say the guiding principles, I believe the first one is heritage conservation.
Yeah.
Well, if then let's look at the heritage conservation law and see how well they've done by it. The Supreme Court itself, their own so-called green signal, the majority judgment, the minority judgment unequivocal that everything the government has done is illegal. There's no doubt in the minority opinion. It's the majority that even they are troubled by the way this government treats heritage law by insisting that they get clearance from a heritage conservation committee that finds its origins in law.
Yeah.
You know, it's almost like if you fail to show up for your examination, the question paper and the answer sheet is sent home and said, "Tum karke, just fill it up, sign at the bottom and send it back to me." So my point is that, you know, we all have these statutes in place to preserve and to improve the quality of our collective lives. Heritage is a very important part of our quality of our lives,
yeah,
built heritage particular. So
they've
evaded. I think there are various articles written about how they've tried to evade using, you know, fabrication of authority by making CPWD a local body so that it doesn't need to go to NDMC for sanction and so on. I won't get into the details.
I think I just wanted to ask that question also, I mean, pointedly to you, Madhav, because, you know, that's a serious error, because I have been a deputy mayor of Simla, and I know, I mean, even if you have to construct a house, you know, the kind of transparency that is required is like, phenomenal.
But actually,
it's a local body. It's a local body which is enshrining the task.
Absolutely. As a mayor of Shimla, if you had to deal with unauthorized construction, you would order your commissioner to take a bulldozer and go and demolish illegal construction. Right. Now, that is how local bodies assert their policing authority. That's how they enforce their master plan.
Yeah.
Now, the fact here is, The ministry seems to think it's perfectly all right to make CPWD, which is really the construction arm of the government of India. It's like a contractor. It's a developer. Is going to self-sanction by virtue of it being recognized as a local body by Delhi Urban Arts Commission. And Delhi Urban Arts Commission isn't even authorized to give such recognition. So you fabricated it.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
My point is, all of us, when we build our buildings, if we encroach on public land, if we violate bylaws, if we build more than what is sanctioned, we face the threat of demolition.
Actually.
Right. And if I have to look at the national signal, this is the premium national space. It's our democratic heart. Do you and I want to live in a country where the democratic heart, the space that represents, well, they call governance, I call democracy, in this country, to live in the ignominy that is going to be an illegally occupied, illegally constructed space forever? Mr. Puri refers to it as being there for 250 years. I can't imagine a greater shame than to say that something has been built so illegally. And you see, the Supreme Court was not asked whether the buildings comply to bylaws or they comply to development regulations. The Supreme Court was asked whether they felt the government had moved in a way in which it is empowered to do so or not. Now,
but they have Madhav invoked the provisions of the, you know, that Government Building Act 1899.
No, in fact, they've denied. Yeah. They have denied in their statement. This is actually some very astute people have identified this trick of allowing CPWD to be local body.
Yeah.
They have denied the fact that they're using Government Building Act. They insist that this is as per democratic norms. Now, my point is, I'm not on democracy. That is for the lawyers to argue. I am on what architects need to consider and what we all as dutiful citizens trying to adhere to a master plan and development controls all commit ourselves to. That is civic consciousness, that is civic responsibility, civic duty, that you don't build illegally. Now, in a government that has making us, they're now in the process of making the next master plan, 2041. What is the value of that piece of paper? It's not worth the paper it's printed on because of this project.
Yeah.
They talk about guiding principles, right? So heritage we spoke about, right? There is a deliberate malafide intention and action on the government in terms of reducing what is called the Central Vista Heritage Precinct into a collection of heritage buildings. They're not going to touch the buildings, they say, but you consider that the new parliament is going to be 3 stories higher than the old parliament. You don't touch it, but you definitely reduce its glory. You definitely violate its sanctity as a heritage space. It's like building a glass tower next to a
shrine. Is it the reason why we find, you know, playing with the MPD, the Master Plan of Delhi? I mean, you know, that FAR from 120 to 200. I mean, this is how we conclude that, is it?
You see, I'll tell you the other trap of appointing a contractor as your local body, which is what they've done with the CPWD.
That's the CPWD.
You look at the submissions they've made in the environmental impact assessment. They have said that the permissible FAR here is 200. And they have declared we have achieved 200. But if you bother to divide the numbers they have submitted themselves, it comes to an FAR of 300, which is a violation of 50%.
Yeah.
That means you're allowed to make a three-story building, you make a five-story building.
Yeah, true.
These errors have a remarkable way of helping this project forward rather than, you know, if I made errors in my submission to local body, my project would stop. They would steal the building. But somehow, the nature of these errors is such that it gets them approvals. Now, you and I can have different opinions on why that is happening. Yeah. Or we can have a same unspoken opinion on how these approvals are being got. But the fact is, the error remains on paper. They cannot fudge the numbers they've submitted themselves. So this is why you need an independent local body. And another point they make about the NDMC being a nominated body and not a elected local body, I beg to differ. The NDMC has 13 members in its council.
Yeah, they have elected people, yeah.
Yes, and they have 3 elected people and 4 members who are supposed to be eminent personalities appointed by in consultation with the chief minister. So there's a fair bit of expertise, independent expertise and independent local
representation. Madhav, if I would say it's worse than the elected institution, but it is better than the CPWD.
Oh, definitely. Absolutely.
Yeah.
No, you can't expect the contractor in no condition. Yeah. As an architect, I'm telling you, the contractor is not incentivized to stick to the law. They have to be penalized into compliance. Yeah. That is the only way, because they are profit-motivated people.
Okay. So the second principle, I think, Madhav, which where we should jump from heritage is, you know, what they're saying, expanding public space. I think it's not an error. It's a scandal what they're mentioning. And they're blatantly mentioning it. I mean, what is it that is happening? So I think
impunity. This
public space. Yeah, with impunity. Yeah.
How do you get this impunity? By dumbing down the public, infantilizing us. Now, public space comes under 2 categories. They can be public space that is privately owned and public space that is publicly owned. So say temple grounds, which are privately owned temple, could be public space because you allow melas to happen, but it's owned by a private individual or a private legal person. Public owned public space, that is government owned public space, is actually public owned public space. They have a fiduciary responsibility.
Government is just a fiduciary, it's just a custodian. Yeah. just
the ministry has a feudal mentality. They are the people with the colonial hangover. They are the people with the white man's complex.
I'm glad you brought in this whole. I mean, we call it jargon. I mean, there's terms of feudalism and feudal mentality.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. You can see their statement. You see, even in court, the government, the Solicitor General representing the ministry, claims that they are landowners. Now, if being a government in a democratic system, you are a government in power for 5 years. So that ownership of land is transitory and it is fiduciary. That's the important
Absolutely.
Thing. You're holding it
true.
In trust, right?
Absolutely true.
Now,
Absolutely.
In that trust, you have allocated land use. Now, we'll come into public land being defined by use. You can have recreational public land and you can have public, semi-public use. That is for museums, health centers, galleries. They say we are increasing public land. All they are doing is, if there was X amount of land to be district park and recreational park in Central Vista, they are actually, what they have done is, they have violated heritage norms by changing the plot lines of IGNCA building, adding 2 acres to the Central Rajpath lawns, but on the other hand, removing 1/3 of it for surface level parking. So net, we are in a loss of green area, but we are passing it off as an increase in public land. And all other compensatory greens, they have taken over district park to build parliament also.
Yeah.
So all the compensatory greens are where? They are located, if you look at the land use change in this thing, Timarpur, in Chandrawal Nagar. So that's where we find our recreational space.
And I think from here, another principle, I think, Madhav, where we really need to, it's a big scandal if that is true, because that's what I saw in their reply, and the minister who has been advocating. It's a TOD, one of the guiding principles happens to be TOD, because you have a metro underneath connecting all this stuff. And this is exactly what they said. I mean, the reverse that they said in the Supreme Court, that it's not. And TOD, for an architect, for a planner, people know, but they know, but not the people.
Isn't it
land monetization? Yeah.
So they've clearly gone, they've submitted in Supreme Court, they don't intend to do TOD here, but the minister and the ministry themselves are now making public statements that this is a transit-oriented development guided project.
Yeah.
Guiding is not what we need, compliance. I'll say that again, compliance.
Yeah.
TOD has certain specific requirements. There is a 30% mandatory residential component. 30% of your FAR generated has to be residential. Are they going to now house ministers in their?
Is it so? Yes, that's what I'm asking.
So it doesn't qualify as TOD.
Yeah.
Them saying it's TOD doesn't make it so. It has to comply to TOD to get the TOD excess FAR. That is what they want. The guiding principle is, can they be guided to the excess FAR? But you can't just get it like that. You know, it's a give and take. You have to, then the second thing is, you have to have reduced parking. TOD for government use takes parking norms from 2 cars per 100 square meters of FAR use and brings it down to 1.8. The parking they've submitted in their EIA is 40% more than this norm. So so just calling it TOD is just basically they have decided to reward the CPWD with extra FAR, and they have no way of justifying it. So they use jargonized words like TOD. TOD is meant to develop underdeveloped areas. It's not meant to completely demolish our national heritage.
Father, tell me.
It's going to malign this policy.
Yeah, just correct me. TOD also means land monetization, no?
Well, of course.
Are you not realizing? This could be one of the features, could be, you allow some space when you're creating this large FAR to be further commercialized.
If you look at chapter 12. Of the master plan of Delhi transportation, there's one entire segment called development control regulations for transit oriented development.
Yeah.
That is the law.
Yeah.
By law, now they're allowed to monetize, that is 10% of the FAR they generate can be leased out to companies for private.
That's
offer.
It. Yeah. So what better to have proximity to the parliament?
The ministry is crying about some notional rent of 1,000 crores, which doesn't exist, by the way. All the ministry, I've looked at each ministerial address. They all exist on buildings and premises owned by the LNDO. So the rent that each ministry pays, they pay to LNDO. LNDO comes under Ministry of Housing. Ministry of Housing provides it as income to the government of India. And so the balance book balances. So it's a circular rent. It is a complete fabrication. Existing ministry building, every minister sits in an office that it belongs to the government of India. There is no private rent here. This is a complete fabrication. So this 10,000 crores of rent, if they're bringing in people, the EIA document suggests they're only adding 10,000 people to the existing 50,000 here. So are they saying they're paying 1,000 crores rent currently to house 10,000 employees? That's ridiculous. Then each of them is sitting in a, you know, the most prime real estate in the country at that rate.
So I mean, this is what you are reducing. There's 1,000 crore. What they've been advocating that will be actually saving this money.
Yeah,
I think. And the fourth and the fifth one that they speak about, you know, the green buildings and the inspiring works, modern technology.
Again, cherry picking.
How is it inspiring?
Environmental law has very, very strict. They have spent their entire time dodging environmental law, submitting proposals. The new parliament is submitted as an extension of old parliament in one to one authority. To another authority is submitted as a new parliament. There is constant flexibility. What height are you going to? How many trees? No one knows how many trees are getting cut. Yeah. The EIA suggests that there are about there was a tree cutting, tree transplantation tender, which actually says there are approximately 3,000, but we don't know the numbers. It's up to the winning bidder to ascertain. So, ulta chor kotwal ko dante, or whatever, the chor is the kotwal. You're telling him to tell you how many trees he's going to transplant successfully. I mean, that it just defies all. So, the whole problem stems with a Government of India, Ministry of Housing, Urban Affairs, CPWD, looking at the statutes and laws like they are philosophical discussions. We are in the face of climate change and pandemic. There are changes to our work style. You may unlock construction sites, but offices are still largely working from home. As long as we have our third wave, fourth wave coming in.
Yeah.
You see, the reason of they say, oh, greater efficiency. Do they not use computers and personal devices? Why do they need to sit next to you? Are they going to have a pigeon delivery system? Parinde palne inhone ki wo, they'll attach a letter and it'll fly down the corridor. And is it like Harry Potter with mail delivery by owls? You know, what are they talking about co-location for? You know, there are 260 conference rooms in this complex. 260, each seating 55 people.
Yeah.
Why don't they, like you and I are having a virtual discussion.
Yeah.
Courts have virtual hearings. Yeah. Then what is this idea of having co-location for greater efficiency?
And for whom?
You look at the per employee allocation of space, Tikinder. If you look at what they've submitted in their EIA, They are providing 195 square feet per employee. Now, 80% of the bureaucracy in a ministry is actually less than grade C employees.
Yeah.
So they don't have that luxury. So it's actually the senior bureaucrats and the senior ministries who are giving themselves palatial offices that are the size of bigger than a normal Indian apartment. They've got yoga rooms. They've got music rooms. State-of-the-art gymnasium.
This is being done
as an essential service because we feel that if bureaucrats have music rooms and yoga rooms, they will somehow work for the benefit of our country. That is broadly what I can understand from this set of, both what I read in the paper that the ministry is saying and what they have submitted in the environmental impact assessment. So it's you can't be
thank you Madhav for really bringing out the facts to the fore. And lastly, I think what is important, one of the reasons that the minister has been pointing out is that it's quite environment sustainability. I wish somebody could map the kind of construction activity that is going on, the total quantum of cement and the total quantum of construction material that is going to be used in this entire process. And let me remind our audiences that, you know, if you see the total carbon emissions in the last three decades, 50% of the total carbon emissions in the history of our evolution actually has come in the last three decades. And just 20 companies in the world are responsible for 33% of these emissions. And both and these 20 companies are mainly into cement and fossil. So you have more cars. I mean, I as a person who has served the city for 5 years, I would tax people more if they have to come in the cars. Actually, what we require is a different kind of mobility, a different kind of habitat that we are creating. I think this is not... Tikinder,
you're setting the standards way too high for the CPWD. I'll be very honest with you. It's a very simple thing. In their environmental impact assessment, where they are trying to do an environmental management plan with no qualms, they have admitted they're going to demolish 4.5 lakh square meters of building space.
Yeah.
Their intention is to construct approximately 16.5 lakh new construction.
So imagine.
You looked at carbon footprints. 50% of damage, yes, has happened in the past. I will go even further. 30% of that is linked to new construction and construction.
Absolutely.
So if they have...
It's not required.
So if, you know, we feel we should be leading the world in terms of green policies, we are trying to solar electrify ourselves, we are doing so many things, but these are all at the consumption end. You know, one of the principles, if we are talking about philosophy,
that's why I added those carbon
guiding principles is reuse, reduce, recycle. So reuse. And one of the guiding principles of government office chapter in master plan is the decentralization of government. So if they want to have guiding principles, they should stop looking at laws and trying to give them philosophical interpretations.
I think, Madhav, we also need to build this argument in the context of those sustainable development goals, the 17 SDGs that we are talking about.
I'm deeply saddened by this project as a practicing architect because it takes my city's master plan and tears it to shreds. It takes whatever work anyone is doing on the environmental front. You know, I, being an architect, I'll be the first to admit, construction, by definition, kills the environment. There is no way of escaping it. But all of us are trying various ways to build more conservatively, to build more frugally, to make buildings that are significant so that they last.
Yeah.
And they last not just, you know, on one hand, they keep saying that these buildings are 100 years old. They're demolishing all the ones that are only 40 years old. Yeah. Or the last biggest, 2011 Jawaharlal Nehru Bhavan is a state of the art, cutting edge, green building, green rated building.
And
250 crores was spent in 2011 building that building, and they're demolishing it without a qualm.
So this
is not even greenwash. This is just a fabrication and obfuscation. And this is either one can conclude that the CPWD is extremely incompetent or it is extremely malafide. There are only two conclusions that can be drawn.
Madhav, now this is what I'm asking everyone. I mean, wherever I'm able to interact with our guests, what do you think is the future?
The future?
Yes.
Of this project?
Of this project, yeah.
So the thing is that it's off late because of the construction going on during the pandemic surge. It has come up into much political discussion. I just, as a genuine responsible citizen of this country who wants to not allow something that is my most sacred democratic space to be argued about with the politics of the day, I want to have a longer term perspective on this. My biggest problem that deeply saddens me, Tikinder, more than anything else, is the humiliation of having our capital complex, where we will draft laws, where we will legislate from, where we will administer this glorious, vast federal country with so many stakeholders from a place that will forever be illegal.
Yeah.
Because now they have done the deed of so-called getting it sanctioned. Okay. The only way they can redeem it is by declaring it illegal and then trying to regularize it, which is shameful. We have 70 years of democracy in this country down the drain with this project.
Thank you. Thank you, Madhav, for speaking to us. And I wish that the fate that we saw with the Walkschild in Germany, I mean, what Albert Speer and Hitler, I wish something of that sort could be repeated.
Yeah. See, in the long run, Germany has done a lot to remedy the excesses during the war.
Yes.
Right? The UK does a lot to remedy the excesses during the, although arguably not enough, but to remedy the excesses during colonial rule.
Yeah.
So every government, eventually, history will judge from a distance of time I'm just saying, as a citizen of this country, living today, responsible for my future generations and future citizens of this country, I feel the biggest shame I will carry with this project is the fact that it will stand illegal. You can have discussions about buildings being legal and illegal when they're not there. But once they're there, you bear the shame. You bear the shame.
Thank you, Madhav. It was very nice speaking to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. Thank you.
Thank you.